topic is one that I don't usually give speeches about, but it's one that I've been wanting to do for a while, for 6 or 8 months now. The history of this, if you go way back, is that ever since I got serious about game development, I've been interested in my own psychology and managing my own psychology, because I knew that my own psychology had been a barrier to me getting things done previously. I don't want to rat hole too much about that. Around the time that I started working on a game called Brave, which ended up being a relatively long project, 3.5 years long, that seemed long at the time. Since then, of course, I've done things that are substantially longer. I knew that I wanted to break with my prior history of, you know, starting projects and then some months in losing the motivation, or, you know, getting into states where intellectually I knew that I really wanted to do this thing because it would be cool, but like somehow just feeling down about it and feeling, you know, bummed and just not being able to dig myself back into a place where I could work effectively on these things. And so I became interested in that, in monitoring my own psychology and just watching it. And over the past 12 or 13 years now, I've encountered a number of different ideas about, you know, how to do that, or what's important, or how do you keep yourself driven and motivated. And, you know, as with anything, I think most of those ideas are pretty bad or unhelpful. What I'm going to share today are the ideas that have helped me the most and that I think are the most worthwhile to communicate to other people. The rest of the story of the genesis of this talk is just that at HandmadeCon last year, I was on a panel, and somebody asked me a question about how to keep motivation for longer projects, and at that time I gave an answer that was vague and short, because I didn't want to take too much time, it was a panel, but, you know, I really felt that answer was true and helpful, but actually too vague to be actionable, because there was no way people would know what to do. So my goal this time is to just get enough information out there and enough detail that you can try these techniques on your own after the video and see if they work for you. Don't believe me that these are the best possible techniques for dealing with motivation and depression types of issues. But just, you know, give them a try if you like them. You know, keep doing them if you like them. Don't keep doing them. Now, I did just say something about, like, motivation and depressive feelings and stuff, and it's not necessarily obvious that those are really the same thing, but I see them on a spectrum of things that it's sort of the same thing manifesting at different levels of seriousness in the life of a software developer. You know, I've been programming for about 35 years, and I'm very familiar with what it feels like to sit down in front of a computer and program, and I think it's not too surprising that sometimes we are beset by negative emotionality, right? I think, for example, that computers are fundamentally depressing because our body does not expect in its natural state to be, you know, motionless, first of all, and focusing on a thing that is artificially, you know, flashing and changing in a way that generates potentially a lot of tension. So we shouldn't be too surprised, let's say, if malaise kind of arises, or your body wants to start to say, like, I don't feel like I should be here, right? I should be somewhere doing something else. So that's all just to say that that, plus the fact that these projects that we try to do in video games and other parts of software development are they're very intense in terms of the amount of work you have to do and the quality of work you have to do. And so I feel like there's a little bit of an unspoken epidemic, or maybe not an epidemic, because I don't think it's exactly contagious in that way, but there's a bigger problem out there than people readily admit, or at least think of, consider, because most people aren't going to talk about how they're depressed unless they're just over the cliff and being Eeyore and telling you all the time how they're depressed, right? Most people don't want to be that person, and so they keep it bottled up. But in my experience, a lot of computer technical people, whether they're programmers or other people that sit in front of the computer a lot of the time, are unhappy for a great percentage of the time that they're sitting in front of the computer. And we can leave, there's a whole other part of the discussion about how social media type sites that we have these days are engineered probably to make us even more unhappy than we would otherwise be. Let's table that and even just say that just regular working life is probably unhappy to speak. And so I think we need techniques to deal with this. So I'm giving you my best techniques. These are not Western psychological techniques. They come from meditative traditions. But they're very simple. You don't have to be some kind of super meditator in order to be these things, in order to do these things that I'm going to talk about. In fact, some of them are going to be so simple that they seem like basically nothing, and you'll be like, how is that supposed to help me in my life? But hopefully I will do a good enough job explaining how these can help, that they'll make sense. And we'll do a little bit of them as we sit here. So maybe that's enough preamble. I really don't like a lot of preamble. So let's talk about experiences of negativity that you might have, either in your day-to-day working life or that build up over a long time around a project, right? And like I said, these can be anywhere on the spectrum from a lack of motivation to like full-out depression and inability to work and just negative affects spilling over into all parts of your life. And to have something very concrete to talk about, I'm going to go toward the more negative end of that scale, because if we talk about like subtler lack of motivation, it's harder to grip something. Whereas I think most of us have been depressed at least a little bit, right? We know what that feels like. It's a very negative feeling. But the reason it's such a problem is that when it's happening, it feels very serious, right? It feels looming and unavoidable, like there's a big problem and we don't know how to deal with it. And it's hard to bear, right? And in its very worst cases, it can feel unbearable, right? We just can't deal with it. And so the techniques that I'm going to talk about today are about sort of turning down the volume on that kind of problem, mitigating it, you know, diluting it, if you think of it as ink or something, until it's not really unbearable, right? Until it's not so serious, until it's not so looming, until it's actually small. And it's amazing how much that can do for you. So we're going to take a divide and conquer approach. If you talk about the experience of being depressed or very negatively emotional, for our purposes today, we're going to divide that into a few parts, and then we're going to approach each part and attack each part separately. And then when you put them back together, because we've made headway on each part, the whole is not so bad, right? It's exactly like an engineering problem. You might start with a problem and it seems daunting, and then you break the problem down into separate steps, and then you solve each individual step, and then you've got a full solution, right? So this is something that engineers are very familiar with. So when we're having a negative time, there's several things happening, and you can categorize them very broadly into thoughts and emotions, right? So you might have negative thoughts, such as, oh my God, this project is taking so long, right? I'm just tired, I can't do it anymore, or I'm going to be bankrupt and it'll fail and I won't finish it and nobody will respect me, right? Or, I'll release my thing that I expect to be so great and everybody will judge me, just like I saw them making harsh comments about that other thing, and everyone will think I suck and I'll be seen as a fraud and a failure, whatever. Whatever your personal thoughts are probably a little bit different from everybody else's. But you can imagine what they are. My personal thoughts actually are not really those ones that I said. They're different ones. But everybody has different thoughts. Now, we're going to disregard for today whether those thoughts are actually true or false. In fact, a great many of them may be true, but that doesn't mean that it has to create a depressive situation, right? So we're not going to take an approach of, like a lot of people on the internet who are like, feel good people, or I'm such a good friend, or whatever, will just try to tell you, oh, that's not true, you know, and get you to do this reality denial kind of therapy on you. That's very bad therapy, right? It's not going to work very well. What works well is being impervious to whether particular ideas are true or false, right? So the other thought part of that is the emotions part. And with emotions, we're actually going to break that down into two parts. With any emotional state, there's the non-physical part of the state that's a more abstract thing, like happiness or sadness or something like that. But emotional experiences are always also grounded in the body. So for any type of emotional experience you can think of, there's a physical part and a non-physical part. So if I'm nervous, you know, going into a job interview, I might have a vibrating chest or tight muscle sensations or something. And then I also have some kind of, the color of the light in the room of my mind is in some kind of like flinchy, I'm a little bit, it's not exactly fear, but it's a precursor to fear, you know? If I'm angry at somebody, there might be this predisposition toward attacking them, right? It's hard to explain these abstract parts of them. I can just say anger, right? There's the anger part, but there's also then, physical corollaries of anger, like I'm flushed, I might I might be kind of tensing my arms if I'm thinking about taking a hostile stance or something like that, right? So there's these two parts of every emotional experience, and we're going to treat each of those parts separately and investigate them separately. And then we'll put them all back together at the end. So let's start with thoughts. And the number one thing to realize that will help you the most when having thoughts is to realize ultimately that there's a limit to how important your thoughts actually can be because you are not your thoughts. If I say you are not your thoughts, either you can be very confused by what that means or it can seem very obvious. Right? Like, I'm a human being, what do you mean I'm not my thoughts? But in the West, we have this really strong identification. We think of our personality as being composed of our thoughts, right? Like, I am this guy who thinks certain things and makes certain decisions, right? And whereas it's true that I think certain things, and make certain decisions. That's actually a tiny portion of what it's like to be me at any given moment. And so what helps with thoughts is that at times like this, when you're in a safe environment, you know, nothing's too emotionally pressing on you or something, you just take a look at what thoughts are really like. Because you know that later, if you're in a trying time, very emotionally negative time, you can feel trapped in thoughts, right? You can be having this chain of negative thoughts that's helping make you depressed, and the thoughts just seem very important and hard to get away from. And what you do is, before that, you build a certain habit of standing apart from your thoughts and seeing them and getting some distance on them. So, we can just do a really simple exercise like that. So, you can just be sitting around wherever you are, or standing, or whatever, laying down, whatever you're doing. With your eyes open, you just look around. So, I'm looking around the room, and I'm seeing the room around me. I'm very aware that I have this full audio-visual experience, right? I'm feeling things. I'm feeling the chair that I'm sitting in. I'm hearing the fireplace and the myself talking in your heart. So while all this stuff is going on, without turning your attention away fully from these things that you see, just have some simple thoughts in your head, you know, sentence-style thoughts, like, you know, I wonder what I'm going to have for dinner tonight, or something that's emotionally charged. Some people might be very upset about dinner right now, so pick something that for you is just completely emotionally uncharged, just a thought that you can observe. Second, if your attention goes completely into the thought, just remember that and just blow it back out to the whole room, right? And so you observe your thoughts going by in a case like that, and two things happen. One is that you see that your thoughts are actually a small portion of your experience, right? You can't be your thoughts because you were here in a room, or I'll just speak because I know where I am. I was here in this room and I was seeing this nice view, and then I started thinking something about the PlayStation over there. And I saw that thought come, and I saw it happen, and then I saw the thought go. But all this other stuff was still there. I mean, my view was changing slightly in my head, and the fire's changing slightly, but for the most part, you know, most of my experience was not comprised by that thought. And that's very simple, right? Like, nobody's really going to be confused by this. But it's amazing when you're in a high-pressure situation how bad these thoughts can be, because we have a way of being captured by thoughts and pulled by them. And so the first thing that happens is that you see, oh, thoughts are actually really very small, right? The second thing that you do is you get practice at observing your own thoughts from a little bit of a distant viewpoint, right? You see your thoughts happening, and you get in the habit of seeing your thoughts happening. And then when you're in a more heightened emotional state, you have a better chance of sooner than you would have otherwise, being able to step back from the thoughts that are happening and not be so enraptured by them. So now there's a few other things you can do. Conjure up whatever other neutral thoughts you're thinking of and just prod them a little bit. Like, just observe the beginning of the thought and the end of the thought, and how long does it take for that thought to go by? And how heavy is a thought? This might seem like a nonsensical question, but try to see how much next thought weighs. Can you hold it, right? Does it weigh anything? And of course the intellectual answer is, of course not. What are you talking about? A thought is a thing in my head, right? But the point of this is not intellectual answers. The point of this is for you to directly experience something that you may not have bothered to look at, and to sort of let certain kinds of observations soak more into the way that you are from moment to moment, right? So how heavy is the thought? You know, I wonder, I probably should have taken care of that box on my counter by now. Can I stop that at a particular word? Can I stop that thought? How solid of an object is that thought? Can I stop that thought at a particular word, like box, and then hold it and let it go? Or does something happen when I try to do that? Right? I'm going to do that for another few seconds. Stop a thought in the middle. Okay, so that's about all we're going to say for thoughts. Now, we'll come back to them, because once we do a couple of other things, they'll become important again. But so, again, the two points here, and they seem simple, but if you actually take this seriously, change a great deal, right? So the first thing is, this kind of simple observation helps us from identifying so closely with thoughts, so that we're not so immediately reactive to them, right? Because we're able to realize that our awareness of the thought is separate from the thought itself, right? And we're developing that viewpoint. we're developing the strength of the viewpoint of being aware of a thought rather than just being the thought. And so often happens when our mind gets carried away. So, the next thing we're going to talk about is that bodily sensations and part of emotionality, right? As I said, emotions have a physical part to them, and you'll be very, if there are any emotions that you experience frequently, you'll be very familiar with what that physical part feels like. And there's a technique that is very, very useful for feeling in to those physical parts of adverse experiences, right? Which will help you with those adverse experiences. But fortunately, we're able to practice these kinds of techniques on totally neutral sensations, right? So, what we're going to do right now is a simple physical sensation exercise. So I'm sitting in a chair, and I'm going to put my attention on the feeling of my butt meeting the chair, right? There's some amount of pressure there where my body is being supported by the chair. If you're laying down or standing, you can pick some analogous situations. Standing is a little bit harder, right? Because it's higher pressure, there's more pressure on your feet. But pick anything like that. And you know, I recommend closing your eyes and you just look at that sensation. What does it feel like when you sink your attention into it? Is this sensation a solid object, or is it an ethereal thing? And is it a well-defined thing? Does it have solid edges? Is it a well-defined area? Or is it a fuzzy and indistinct area? If you were going to draw a picture of it on a piece of paper, what would you draw? Would you draw a solid outline with a constant shade on the inside? Because that's what my mind tells me, right? My thinking mind says, well, there's some butt-shaped shape where I need the chair, and that's what I would draw. But is that actually what you see when you drop your attention into that sensation, or do you see something else, right? If you see a firm boundary at the edge of the sensation, investigate whether it's really there by focusing your attention more closely on that boundary. If there's really a boundary, you should be able to see it with greater sharpness, shouldn't you? You should be able to locate it exactly. I don't find any such thing. I'm opening my eyes now, you're welcome to do so. I don't find any such thing when I do that kind of investigation. What I find is a very very vague, spread out feeling. If I were to draw it on a piece of paper, it would be very wispy and maybe with some specks that appear and disappear and show up in different places. But as soon as I draw back my attention to start speaking to you again, what I find is that when I'm no longer directly looking at it, my mind again has this sensation that there's a solid meeting of my butt with the chair, right? So my idea of what it feels like to sit down seems to change based on how I direct my attention. And this is pretty important if you follow it everywhere that it goes. There's some kind of a layer of interpretation that your mind is constructing, right? So you have some sensations coming in from your body, and they're very vague and ill-defined, and one of the jobs of your mind is to make sense of these sensations and put them together into some picture about the world that you can then deal with, right? And so one of those things that it does is it makes things feel more solid than they actually feel. But by dropping your attention, you're able to feel past that layer of interpretation into, I don't exactly know how much they're raw sensations, but into something that is, let's say, not yet post-processed or something like that, right? You're able to feel something that is less useful in terms of navigating the world of solid objects, but that is more truly what it actually feels like to sit on a chair, right? It's not a synthesis. And you know, it's interesting to, you know, again, I can put my attention on this computer over here, and maybe it feels more solid back there, but then I drop my attention back there, and there's a moment during which my attention just sort of feels the illusion of solidity dissolve, and I feel what the sensations are actually like, right? And there's a game that I like to play that's more like a faster version of this, which is I can take something like my hand and just put it on a table like now, and anytime I move and make an initial contact with something, usually my body or my mind starts interpreting that pressure as an onset of a solid sensation, but by focusing my attention on it, I can very quickly dissolve my experience of that sensation into something very wispy and unsolid. And so it's a nice game to play. I can just say, okay, my hand is up, my hand is down, and how quickly am I able to drop into the sensation such that I get past that layer of interpretation. Up, hands down. Pretty fast, but it's not instantaneous for me, right? But it doesn't need to be, because what I'm after today is more seeing the difference between that layer of interpretation and the more raw, low-level sensations beneath it. Now, it's important when you're doing this exercise, and for all these exercises that we're going to talk about, that you're not really trying to dictate a particular experience. You don't want to be trying to feel a certain exact thing. You don't want to try to be too much in control of what you feel. You don't want to have an agenda. The right mindset is investigation, right? You're inquiring into what does this sensation of my hand on the table feel like if I just look at it more closely than I may be in the habit of doing in everyday life. And it's funny because on the one hand, the way it feels is very familiar. Like, I know that's how it feels. It's been that way my whole life. But on the other hand, until I started doing this, it didn't really sink in that that was a thing, or that that might be important to consider, right? Now, we've been talking about this on a neutral sensation so far, but this works on any kind of sensation. It It works on sensations of discomfort or sensations of pain by dropping into the sensation. You can dive past the layer of interpretation and get to what you are basically feeling physically. And the interesting thing that you find when you do that is that the actual sensation is neutral, and it's your interpretation that's making it negative. And it sounds like some extreme guru power to be able to do that, but actually anybody can do it. It's really not hard. So one day some years ago, just to give you an illustration, after I'd first been learning these techniques, I ate at a pretty bad restaurant in my neighborhood, or it was bad back then, and I got food poisoning, and it was a really bad case of food poisoning. I was sick in bed for 2.5 days, just shivering as my body was, generating a fever to kill all the germs, and just pain in my stomach, and I was feeling really miserable, right? Or I was feeling miserable until I realized, I've been learning these introspection techniques, and this seems like a good time to try them out, right? So, in the same way that we were just looking at these basic physical sensations, like what it's like for the pressure of one surface to meet another surface, I did that to look at my stomach pain or the full body extreme unpleasantness of running a really high fever and shaking and sweating really grossly, right? Just looking at all those sensations, and very quickly, I was able to turn my experience from a miserable one into an experience of neutral observing or neutral experiencing of these sensations that were coming up from my body. Now, it was a little bit difficult in that case because it was a relatively strong experience, and so from time to time I would lapse in my I don't exactly want to say concentration because it wasn't concentration, but I would lapse in my ability to maintain this viewpoint, and I would be miserable for a few minutes, but then I was able to dive back in, right? And that was a very interesting couple of days. It taught me a lot about experientially about what negative feelings are like. Now, from a scientific viewpoint of the human organism, we actually know all this, right? So if you cut your hand or scrape it on something and you have this feeling of pain, we know that what's really happening is, you have some nerves in your skin, and they transmit some impulses, and that's just like information going over a network. And then some part of your mind is in charge of knowing what body-harming patterns, or what patterns of impulses are likely to indicate harm to the body, and to assign negative sentiment to those things, right? We know, if we're scientifically educated, that is what the physical human body does, but somehow we don't let it sink into our day-to-day behavior, right? But this is a very direct way to experience that sensations are actually neutral. And in the same way, in the way that we were, when I was feeling the sensation of my butt on the chair, and the way that I dove past a layer of interpretation very easily to get to the sensation underneath. In the same way, you can dive past that layer of interpretation of pain as being negative, and you can experience just what it is, which is some sensations, some feelings. Now, the stronger the pain or the negative sensation is, the more difficult this may be, because there's some voice in the back, like, screaming urgently for you to take care of the situation. So, you know, if I were being tortured or something like that, I might have a very difficult time invoking these techniques for very long. I probably could do it for short periods of time. I don't know, I've never been tortured. But for anything less than that, I don't find it to be particularly difficult to engage this writing mind. There are two things that you get out of this. One of them is, I'll repeat, the understanding that sensations are at their core neutral, not negative or positive, right? The negativity or positivity are things that you assign later, and therefore they're not that serious, because the negativity isn't something exactly that's happening to you, right? It's your evaluation of the happening. And that means you have at least some degree of control over it, which again, when we talk about serious depressive situations, gives you a little bit of a way out. But there's another thing that it does, though, which is that long-term, if you do this a little bit, it gives you an understanding of what is being interpreted by your mind, or what is being synthesized by your mind, versus what is not. And what was very helpful for me to see is that a great deal of what I assumed was everyday physical experience was actually interpretations imposed by my mind. And so I'll give you another example about that. I had come home, again some years ago, from a retreat where I was practicing this kind of technique. And it was the next day after the flight in Atlanta. So I was at home, I woke up, it was Saturday, I did some work stuff that I had to deal with, you know, being gone. And then it was like going on noon or afternoon, and I had to go down to get breakfast. And I was very, very grumpy, because over my whole life, I had a sort of what I would tell you was a metabolism thing or a body chemistry thing, where if I don't eat in the morning, I got very, very grumpy, and I could feel my body temperature change, and, you know, my mood would drop, and I would, you know, be very short with people and very, you know, clipped in the way that I'm dealing with them, and like, look, I just want food, come on, And, of course, I had a whole story about that based ostensibly in the scientific understanding of things, like, oh, people have body chemistry, and, like, my metabolism was high, and blah, 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 and something, a lot of hand-wavy, something is happening, and therefore this is a physical thing. But I had, you know, no real proof or evidence of that. And in fact, the fact that I was getting kind of chubby at that point compared to how I'd been previously should have given me a clue that my metabolism wasn't necessarily as high as I thought it was anymore, or that I didn't need food as urgently as I thought I did. But people are very obstinate sometimes. So I was grumpy hill, and I was like, oh man, I wish I could walk down the hill, but the hill is very steep. I just want to go to restaurants that are like 5 blocks away and get breakfast, but if I do that walking, then I have to walk back up the hill to get home, and that's super steep. Like, it's a ridiculous San Francisco hill, and I'm like, bad for my stomach, I'll have an unpleasant experience, so I have to drive, but oh man, it's Saturday, which means the farmer's market is there, which means all the parking is going to be terrible, so I'm going to have to drive around for 15 minutes to find parking, and it's going to be like 8 blocks away, and I'm going to have to go on a long walk when I'm hungry and I just want food. And it was like this spiral of negativity out of like a really simple starting point. But as I was driving down this first hill, fortunately there was no oncoming traffic to think about. It was a very small residential street. I said, oh, you know, I've been using these introspective techniques, or learning them, and I'm having a very negative time right now, so why don't I just look at what's happening, really, internally, right? What am I actually feeling, and why am I feeling it? So I looked at these sensations, these full-body unpleasant sensations that were associated with, oh, I'm so hungry, and that were helping generate this negative state, right? So it was my body temperature dropping low, and it's hard to describe physical sensations that are internal to you that you don't often attempt to describe, but, you know, it was like my whole body marshaled around some situation. But for some reason, as I was just dropping down that hill, or driving down that hill, and I just dropped my attention in to look at what was going on, in 1 or 2 seconds, it was so simple, I just saw straight through all these layers of things that I thought were there, that were a physical situation, and I saw that they in fact weren't really a physical situation that was hard to deal with, and I was able to see the actual sensation of hunger being generated by my stomach in that time. And it was so comically small. It was like the tiniest, tiniest little pinprick of, oh, I'm hungry. A little bit, you know. And it was ridiculous that I was making such a big deal out of it, and this was obvious, right? It was obvious that this whole other giant cloud of things that were happening were all being generated in response to this tiny, tiny pinprick, right? They were, in the way that we've talked about the mind synthesizing an interpretation of my gut on the chair, it's also kind of an amplification of those sensations. And this was like an amplification of this tiny, tiny feeling. It became this full-body emergency, right? But it was all made up, and it was all unnecessary, actually. And ever since then, ever since that 1 to 2 seconds, tiny observation, I've never had this problem again when I get up in the morning. Not completely. You know, I have it about 5 to 8% of what I used to. And when I have a little bit of this happening again, I just look at it and I'm like, oh yeah, it's fine. It's totally, I'm not grumpy anymore. I don't, you know, get into arguments with people for no reason and all that. And it took almost nothing. It took just a second of looking internally. And I was not even particularly experienced in this type of introspection at the time when that happened. It was just, it's just not hard, right? That's all I can say is it really doesn't take much. So, to summarize, for physical sensations, there are two things that you can gain. One is the sensation, or the knowledge that sensations are at their heart neutral, right? Which will help you when you think that you're feeling a negative sensation, right? And the second thing that you gain is this awareness of your mind's amplification strategies, right? And they're not necessarily bad, right? So you could imagine all sorts of reasons why I might have grown up with some kind of amplification strategy for hunger. Maybe when I was a little baby, my parents didn't look after me enough and didn't feed me readily enough, and I learned that I really had to yell or something. I don't know, right? I don't know if that's true. It's just a made-up story to explain that there's, or just to point out that there are legitimate reasons why you might have needed to develop a habit like this when you were younger, not even baby age, but like when you were a teenage or a young adult. But sometimes we develop these habits to get us through a short period, and then they become more trouble than good, right? More harm than good. And at that time, it's at least better to see through them so that you know that they're not inherently necessary. And then you can be free to make decisions about whether you want to comply with what that habit or amplification is telling you or not. All right. So the third part of our situation here is the non-physical parts of emotions. So the things that we would just normally call, you know, sadness or happiness or anger or, you know, glumness or something like that. And what are, I find it always hard to talk about these, but there's something like the way that I'm predisposed toward interpreting new events. Now, if somebody says something, am I going to react to it positively or negatively, right? Like, what color is the light inside the room of my mind? I don't know why that makes sense, but that's a way that I like to think about it. And the reason I put this third is that a very good way to learn to deal with these is exactly the same as we learned for the physical sensations, right? What you do is you put your attention on the emotion that you're feeling and just look at it. You don't try to change it. You don't try to be happy if you're sad. You don't try to be sad if you're happy. You just say, What am I feeling right now? Like, just what does it feel like? That's all. Now, the reason that we did this third is because with physical sensations, it's a little easier to have a guess about where to put your attention. Whereas, if somebody says, put your attention on your sadness or something, you might end up thinking about your sadness, which is not the correct thing to do. Trying to be more sad or something, but just in the same way that you turn your attention to the feeling of your butt on the chair, you turn your attention to your emotional state. And what you'll find, or at least what I find when I do this, is that these emotional states disappear completely, right? When I look at them, they're just gone. Which comes as a surprise, perhaps, when you first start doing this kind of thing, because we have this idea that emotions last a long time, right? Like, if I have a conversation with someone, and we have a strong disagreement, and I get angry, and I leave the room, and I'm still angry. Maybe I'm angry for hours, or maybe I'm angry for days, or weeks, or maybe I form a vendetta that lasts for years, right? Well, that certainly can happen, but it's not because emotions last a long time. emotions by themselves, as you see very clearly when you turn your attention toward an emotional state like that, emotions by themselves don't last very long at all. They're like a fire, or something like that, where without constant fuel, they'll just burn themselves out very quickly. And actually, in the case where you're turning your attention toward investigating the emotional state, you're actually turning your attention away from fueling the emotional state, and so it goes out even faster. And that's just very interesting. It's an amazing thing to observe. So if emotions require fuel to go, what is that fuel? Well, it's something like a thought that prods further emotion or a bodily sensation. And we'll come back and talk about those again in a second. And so, this one is harder to practice in a more neutral setting like this, because you may not be in any kind of heightened emotional state. Probably not, right? You may be in a relatively low-key emotional state, but I would recommend just taking a second trying that out. So, what do you feel like now? How do you feel? Just take a look. Close your eyes. And just view your emotional state, just like you were viewing the sensation of your body being in the chair. Makes all the difference in the world knowledge that even if you're feeling an emotion very strongly right now, and you're not in this kind of neutral observing where you can make it wash away, even if you're feeling it very strongly, you've seen its nature as like something not that strong at all. It's like a piece of tissue paper that you can poke through at will. And so, the way I'm explaining this, it sort of sounds like two redundant things. But the first part was about you can give yourself relief at any time. And this part is about because you can poke through that wall at any time, it's actually not much of a wall. So if you feel like depression is some three-wall prison with thoughts and bodily sensations and emotional states all hemming you in, that emotional state wall is actually the weakest one at all. It's like tissue paper. You just walk through it at any time. And so feeling trapped like that, it's much harder for it to happen, right? It feels more ridiculous. Okay, so taking these three things and putting them back together, what actually happens, right? So we've looked individually at thoughts, we've looked individually at bodily sensations, we've looked individually at emotional states. But what actually happens in everyday life is these things mix and interact. And there's some kind of perpetual motion machine, right? So if I was angry at somebody, and we had a discussion, and I leave the room, and my emotion starts going down, like I was angry, and my anger starts subsiding, it'll get prodded again. I'll have a memory of what they said that I didn't like, or I'll have a picture in my mind of, the body language that somebody held as they said a certain thing to me, and that makes me angry, or maybe when they said that thing originally, I felt embarrassed or flushed, right? And then when I'm remembering what they were saying to me, that flushed feeling comes back, and that provokes some negative emotionality. And then that negative emotionality is, then that negative emotional state predisposes me toward thinking more things about how angry I am, or waking up more negative bodily sensations. So it's like things prodding each other and generating a self-sustaining cluster experience, however you want to say that. Now, the good thing about this is that awareness of any of the things, any individual one of the things that I've talked about so far, will weaken this cycle. So if you didn't even get what I was saying two-thirds of the time, but for one of the things you were like, oh yeah, I get what he was saying about thoughts, or I get what he was saying about physical body sensations, a little bit. That little bit will weaken this part of this self-prodding machine some, right? And as I've said, you can do exercises to observe these things independently and further weaken those walls or those legs of this thing that's happening. But you can also then just observe how this machine is happening in your mind, in your daily life. And that observation, under less dire feeling situations or less life-threatening situations, will help you when things get even more serious. So, as another example, some years after the previous couple examples I gave you, I was just walking down the street one day after having been on the internet in the morning, and we all know that's a mistake, right? So I had some discussion. I don't remember at all what the discussion was, which shows you how important it was. was in the grand scheme of things, not at all. But I've been very angry from this discussion, or at least somewhat angry, right? And angry enough that I was mulling it over in my head while I was just walking down the street. I had nice things to look at, but I was insisting on playing this conversation in my head. And I was looking at one part of what somebody typed on the internet, and part of my mind said, aha, that phrase right there, picked this thing out, and said, that specific phraseology in this context means that that person did not sufficiently respect you, and you should be offended. Aha, I found it, right? And therefore you can attack them back for this and that and that. But having had some practice in these techniques, I had a little bit of that distance of standing back and watching your own thoughts while all this was happening, and I saw it play out. And I realized people are kind of crazy. Like, I'm kind of crazy, and everybody's like this, and everybody's kind of crazy. And what do I mean by that? I mean the following. People will tell you that they don't want to have negative experiences, right? Most people will tell you they want to be happy, right? But what I saw very clearly happening was a part of my mind whose job was specifically to make me more angry, reach out and say, this thing here, right? Be mad about this. It's like the guy who, like, big guy who walks into a bar, like, looking for a fight, and he's, like, kind of drunk, and he's, like, bumping into everybody, hoping that somebody will, like, start something with him, right? It was like that. But I want to be happy, right? So if I want to be happy, why was I creating this problem? Or at least if I didn't create the problem, let's say that I, you know, the other person meant to antagonize me, right? Why was I so willing to step into that and amplify it and propagate it? Well, you can imagine, again, you know, from an evolutionary standpoint, or any technically oriented standpoint that you want to take, you can think of all sorts of reasons why, you know, it's more fit to monitor your social status in a complex social hierarchy, and so on and so forth, right? You can totally make up an explanation for that that makes perfect sense. But that doesn't really make it less crazy to simultaneously think you want to be happy and to simultaneously be self-generating this kind of negativity, or going out of your way to find negativity. And you may think you don't do it, but you probably do. Almost everybody does this all the time. And this will become very clear to you if you start observing this interplay between thoughts, emotions, body sensations, further emotions, further thoughts, and so on. So I just recommend giving that a try. So to review, we looked at thoughts, bodily sensations, and emotional states. And there were sort of two takeaways for each one. So for thoughts, the first takeaway is you shouldn't necessarily identify so closely with thoughts, because you are not your thoughts, and in fact your thoughts are very small. The second part of that is that it's very useful to have a viewpoint of standing back from your thoughts and seeing them happen, because then you won't be so instantly reactive. You'll be a better observer, you'll know more what to do, right? With sensations, the two takeaways are, sensations are fundamentally neutral. They're not fundamentally positive or negative. And a lot of what your mind is engaged in is interpretation or amplification of these sensations, but you're able to see through these and see that lower level truth in what's happening. And I don't want you to believe me on those. To whatever extent you were able to see that during the exercise today, maybe not at all, maybe only a tiny bit, my recommendation is just to go try those yourself, because it's very easy if you just try them for a minute in the middle of the day, you know, while you're having a coffee at lunch or something. And it's very informative to see what you see when you do this. And the third thing about emotional states, the two takeaways are that if you look at them in this earnestly neutral or inquisitive way, they disappear instantly, right? And the fact that they disappear instantly can give you relief when times are hard. And you put all of these things together, the more headway you make into each of these pieces, the less they fit together into this weird machine that propagates negative states like malaise, depression, lack of motivation, and so forth. So you can hopefully at least imagine how if you have this depressive run that's fueled by these things, if you weaken some of them, how it'll decrease that. And then going back to something more subtle like malaise, like I sit down in front of my computer and I intellectually I want to make more progress on my project, but I just can't make myself do it. Like the mouse keeps popping open the web browser to some stupid discussion site or something, right? When that happens, I recommend starting with bodily sensations and see what your body is feeling, because more often than not, you'll have some negative body sensation driving that, and it'll do you a lot of good to observe that. And then the second thing is just to observe thoughts. You can observe feelings as well, but often in those cases, they'll actually be a little bit subtle and backgrounded. Give it a try. This has gone an hour, almost exactly, so I want to close it. We'll do questions in a minute after a short break. There's a last thing I want to say, which is, hey, I'm putting this video on the internet, and I know how the internet goes, and the number one thing I anticipate is for somebody to try to interpret this with maximum uncharitability and come along and say something like, oh, this is like some kind of Christian Science or Scientologist bull crap that is actually anti-science. He's telling you to like do some Eastern woo-woo to make your problems go away and ignore like antidepressants and that kind of stuff. And that's not actually what I'm doing. So let me say clearly that if you have a serious depression problem, I think it's up to you and discussion with medical professionals whether you should take antidepressants or not. I do not wish to register any opinion either way. I have no experience with antidepressants myself, but in previous stages of life, I would have considered myself mild to moderately depressive. I would have sessions of being seriously depressed for days in a row, frequently, right? And now I don't. Now these feelings come on, and they're very small and tiny, and they're like barely there, and they don't really get in my way, and they still seem to be decreasing year after year. So these techniques, even though they seem like almost nothing, have been very, very powerful in my case. They may or may not be powerful in your case, so I'm putting these out there so you can try them. If you don't like them, you don't like them, that's good. On the subject of antidepressants, though, I'm given to believe that a lot of people are unhappy with them. A lot lot of people don't particularly have good experiences with them. So I think it's worth trying alternatives. And, you know, antidepressants are not really like other medicines, right? So for most medicines in science, like a vaccine or an antibiotic, we have an explanation for why it works and a mechanism. And if there's side effects, you know, those maybe kind of happen because the body is very complicated, but we at least understand why some of the side effects are really happening. Whereas with antidepressants, if you look into them, they're really not very well understood. Which is, in part, is why your doctor might go through 6 different antidepressants before, you know, giving you, before giving up or picking the one that worked the best, but still has some unpleasant side effects. I don't want to go on too long about those. It's just to say that, I think that you don't have to be anti-science to not want to use, some of science's weaker medicines of last resort, right? That's all I'm going to say. So, that's it. We're going to take a short break, and I'll be back and take a couple questions. So, 2-minute break. Do I have any specific recommendations for making a habit out of these techniques. You know, I never practiced them, and I'm not really a technique practicer. So for me, it was just about when something bugs me in the middle of the day, naturally, like whatever happens in life, then I remembered to bring one of these into play. And that was all that I needed to make the amount of progress that I have, which is not to say that my amount of progress is exemplary or anything. Certainly, well, who knows? Who knows what could happen if I had diligently practiced these every day for hours? But that's not what I did. Not at all. Someone is asking, when you check your physical sensations or emotional feelings, do you describe them in your mind with literal terms, or is it more about trying to see it as it is? Something that is almost indescribable by language. Yes, you don't want to engage language when you're doing this. That would be a mistake, because then you're looking at your thoughts and not really looking at the actual sensation. So for example, the exercise when I'm just sitting here and I'm feeling my body on the chair and where those two things meet, I don't want to verbalize to myself at all. I just want to see what it feels like. I want to perceive directly what it feels like without mediating with an explanation, because the explanation is going to be inaccurate. And it'll draw your attention to the explanation rather than the sensation. And what we're trying to gain is experience looking at the actual sensation. As someone who values their intelligence a lot, I believe my thoughts to be very important. Because golly, I'm a smart person, I should trust what I think. The idea that thoughts are a small portion of the human experience is something I consider it basically. Thank you. Okay, well, there's lots more to consider. I mean, if I'd wanted this to be an 8-hour thing, it could have been, right? So another thing to consider, if your thoughts are so important, do you choose your thoughts? Do you decide to think any specific thought? Or does it just come out? If you decide, when do you decide to have that thought, right? Or when you're talking to someone, does the next sentence just kind of come out? You know, this is a little bit of a weird thing, because there are certain people who premeditate what they're going to say in their mind before they say it. Those people tend to be a little bit on the autism spectrum, or a little bit very concerned with self-image and wanting to filter everything they say. But then in that case, if you think what you're going to say before you say it, how did you decide that exact sentence that you thought you were going to say? It's not like you opened up a big menu of words and picked this word and then that word and then that word. No, somehow that thought came to you, right? And so one of the very valuable insights that you get when you watch your own stream of thoughts like this is that the thoughts essentially come from outside, right? They come from outside your awareness into your awareness. And you can't particularly say that you, the conscious decision maker, chose to think that particular thought. You might have some model about your unconscious mind generating the thought, but you don't really have control over your unconscious mind. So, yeah. Which is not to denigrate intelligence in any way. I think intelligence is super important. I think a lot of us here are programmers or other technical people, and you really need intelligence to do that kind of work. But it is helpful to look at intelligence more closely. So, someone says, I find you are not your thoughts to be absurd personally and highly confusing. I have trouble understanding what that actually means. What am I then? Well, like I said, there's all this experience around you. And part of that exercise that I was trying to do early on was to pay attention to this stuff around you. Well, let's do this. So, just look in the room or whatever. Just have a relaxed attention. And just for a second, don't think anything. Just stop your thoughts. And do that for as long as possible, alright? So, 3, 2, 1, go. And if you fail and think something, just try again. Just try stopping your thoughts. Have to try this for very long. Even if you flubbed and thought something very quickly, right? There was a time before that thought happened when you were still perceiving these things around you. You still existed. You weren't thinking a specific thing, but you still existed and you still were perceiving, and the things you were perceiving informed where your mind went afterwards. So, if you were looking around at the room, so a thing that I thought that I had earlier was I should have taken care of that box. If I am my thoughts, then where did the thought about the box come from? It had to come from some conscious perception of the box, or maybe not even conscious, but I had to see the box and process the fact that it was there in some way to have a thought about the box. So obviously, there's a big part of me that is prior to thought, that happens before the thought happens. And if you have difficulty stopping your thought, or not thinking something, you can try stopping a sentence in the middle. So I'm going to think the fact, oh, I should have taken care of that box. And I'm going to stop before the word box and try to force myself not to continue that sentence for as long as possible. And by doing that, to whatever degree that you're successful, you can see that there's an effort, right? You can see there's some kind of trying not to let the thought proceed, right? If you can see some kind of trying not to let the thought proceed, and then either succeeding or failing, and the thought keeps going, then it's clear that you're like outside your thoughts looking at them. If you're your thoughts, then how are you seeing your thoughts? Like, what is looking at your thought if you're your thought? Right? How would that make any sense? Like I said, it's weird. Some people have no problem whatsoever understanding this. Other people find it so alien that they don't know what to do. So all I can recommend is you just keep trying these things, right? Or even if it was only 100 milliseconds that you managed not to think a thought while looking, and you feel like, oh, I failed because I could only not think for 100 milliseconds. Did you disappear during that 100 milliseconds? Somehow, did you cease to exist, or were you seeing the room? Or the thought came in. artistic success brought you any peace? Has your approach changed from before the games? It's brought me some amount of peace, but not really the deepest peace. So the deep peace that people really want doesn't usually come from... It doesn't come from what people typically consider to be success. Right? And you know that. Like, that's where the whole money doesn't buy happiness thing comes from. And that's why you see Hollywood stars at the top of their league kill themselves. Right? I mean, sometimes it's due to mental diseases, right? But often, well, how you want to classify things, is a thing, but often people become, let's not even talk about the killing oneself case, just often people in that kind of position are chronically unhappy, even though they've done everything that they would have told you 5 years ago they meant to do, right? So, for me, I definitely find fulfillment in the things that I do. And it makes me happy often, but... I think the actual deeper happiness can be related to artistic work, but it's what happens while you're actively doing the thing that you're most happy with. I don't think it comes from having done it in the past. It doesn't come from thinking about how people have, for me at least, it certainly doesn't come from thinking about how people might have appreciated what I did or whatever. It's more of the serenity of actively performing something that you know is good right now, in this second. That is one of the best feelings that I know. And that can come whether other people acknowledge how good your thing was or not. You know, if you know that what you're doing is good, it's a very special feeling. Have I been to meditation retreats? Yes. In the example of being distracted due to a physical discomfort, the solution there to address what's causing is the solution there to address what's causing the discomfort, or does it become ignorable by shining the flashlight on it, so to speak? Well, it could be both, depending on your personal situation. The case that I was going into, which is very simple, and which is, I think, a universal experience, is to look at the sensation that underlies your interpretation of what your body feels, right? And that anyone can do. Beyond that, there might be reasons for certain sensations. If I'm feeling into my chest and I'm chronically like hunched because I'm unhappy and whatever, you might think that the sensations in your chest are being caused by the physical activity of hunching, and that will be going on, but there's also like, well, actually, your propensity to hunch is happening because of certain sensations in your body, and those things have causes and a history, right? And so, you could attempt to address those if you think they're there for a reason that needs addressing in some particular cases. I'm not going to go into that right now. That's not something that I've even done super much. I haven't needed to do that, but I know that that's the thing that some people do. But for me, large amount of benefit just comes from observing sensations neutrally, without needing to do any kind of further manipulation exercise on it. Do I have any tips for thriving in a world, country, era where it seems like so many things are going wrong? How do you stand back from wanting to help change or improve everything? How do you counteract the feeling of selfishness? You choose to focus on yourself first. So here's the thing. It's very easy in this day where people on the internet are telling you what they think about everything all the time. It's very easy to feel like lots of stuff is going wrong and everything is bad because all this news comes in about bad things. And there are bad things, certainly. There are bad things happening. However, there is a fine art to recognizing what really needs addressing versus what really is a conjuring of your own mind, right? And, you know, what you'll find in all this news of what's going on in the world, you know, most of it is inaccurate to some degree or another. Like, things about who is doing what in the U.S. government and why is probably mostly made up, actually. You know, whatever, like what, I mean, there are real world geopolitical problems happening, but if you really knew the full truth of them, they wouldn't quite look like what you think, right? So certainly, the U.S. has problems with North Korea, right? And you can learn the vague parameters of those things, but I think if you were an expert on the subject, then your understanding of it would be very different from what a random person on Facebook understands, right? And so the random person who gets their news from Facebook, their emotional venting on North Korea vis-a-vis the USA is probably not that helpful, right? It's based on ignorance. So then if that's you, do you really want to be that? Do you really want to devote most of your energy to things that people are telling you, to mythical situations that people are telling you how they're a certain way? Or do you want to spend your energy on things that you actually know something about and can do something about? And so, I choose the latter, right? And the way these techniques can dovetail into that is, you can just, after a while, you learn when you're projecting something versus when you're authentically experiencing something. And so, I turn my attention towards things that I'm really experiencing and put my effort in there. And that doesn't preclude helping out with things, right? So when these hurricanes hit Texas and Florida and Puerto Rico, you know, I made donations to the relief funds. You know, I didn't say, oh, those are far away things that have nothing. But that's just because making a donation to those relief funds seemed very probably like it would actually help people in reality. reality to some degree or another, right? What I don't know anything about whether it would help people is to get mad about whether Trump did or did not send something in time or anything like that. Because none of that, I don't know anything about any of that stuff, and neither do you guys, right? So I choose, well, I'm trying to develop the habit of choosing to provide mental energy and physical action when that's appropriate toward things that I am sure are real or that have a higher probability of being real. And, you know, it's up to you how you want to do that. This is a recommendation. Well, I say hi from Chris to Chris Hecker for you next time I see him. I don't know who you are, Elvis Snake, so I could say that, but it wouldn't be meaningful to me. How to go back from neutral state to the emotional one. Your emotions are dogged, most likely, and they will have no problem coming back. Don't be worried about, like, oh my god, I'm going to turn myself into Spock or something. That's not going to happen, because your emotions will rise up again at the slightest provocation. Like mindfulness or Buddhism? If so, how do you feel these things influence your thinking? I've been to a bunch of retreats about a bunch of different things. The stuff that I was talking about today, which I feel is the most useful thing to communicate on these subjects, doesn't exactly fit into Buddhism or mindfulness or anything, although both of those practices are heavily related. Like, they both do things that dovetail directly into this, and the skill sets cross over and all that. I mean, maybe what I said fits. I mean, it sort of fits into both, but it would be a very specific subset of either of those things, right? Like, Buddhism is a very large thing, and a lot of it, I think, is unhelpful to modern people. I am not a Buddhist, for example. I am not, say that. Interesting that I didn't mention meditation for people who like the exercises and want to go further on the thoughts front. Well, I feel like people have heard of meditation. I don't need to tell people that there's a thing called meditation that exists. So I'm not doing that. I felt more inclined to share these specific techniques. Wow, I might miss, I'm at the top of the chat, and it's scrolling off the top, and I'm answering questions there. So I may miss questions. I'm sorry about that. Do I think games as a medium are inherently better able to explore this interior-exterior relationship? And I missed the rest of the question. Maybe, but it's hard to say how. Maybe the rest of the question would help me answer it more detail. Not a question, but just want to say thank you. I've been in a funk recently, and it's definitely helped. It will help, and it will help so much, especially just the permission to sit there and feel your bodily sensations. Because in a funk implies that there are bodily sensations happening. you might be more thinking of the emotional state or even the thoughts, but the bodily sensations are there, and if you look at them, it'll help. It'll really help. Could I talk a little bit about my experience with Zen meditation as opposed to mindfulness meditation? Do I see them as two sides of the same coin, or questions from above? I have never done Zen meditation, so I've never done Zazen. I've never gone to a Zen monastery and spent time there as a monk. So I can't tell you anything about that. I've done various other forms of meditation, and I have some favorites. But it really, I think going into those in detail would be a thing for another time. it would take hours. I mean, if you're interested in meditation, then go ahead and explore it, and all I would have to say there is be wary of anybody who wants money from you in order to teach meditation, or certainly, more than renting the room that it takes to tell you something, right? If somebody wants thousands of dollars to teach you meditation, be wary of that, and be wary of people who want too much attention. Like, if you sense some kind of guru worship situation, just get away from that, because that's not... Why does that help anyone? What is worshiping some guru have to do with the truth of daily reality as we experience it? Those are very different things. And so there are all these traps set up out in the world for people who are interested in meditation. So avoid those, but see what's out there and see what you've got. Which of the three elements do you think is more prominent when feeling empty, undecided, or deciding what to do after a long project? I'm having a hard time being confident in setting a new long-term goal. Well, so instead of focusing on any one of those categories, once you have practice at, or if it came naturally to you, but at tuning your attention to any of those, you can then it's a slightly meta skill, but you can then just sit back in an observational inquiry way and say, what's happening for me right now? Are thoughts happening? Are emotional states happening? Are bodily sensations happening? What is going on? And then you can see what's going on, and it's a good chance that whatever is going on right now is helping to create whatever negative or uncertain state that you're having right now. And being uncertain about what you want to do is not bad. Like, maybe you just don't know. Maybe you have to be okay with not knowing for a while, too. That's the thing, for sure. When did I start doing these things, and how quickly did it affect my work and motivation? I would say probably I started with these specific kinds of things around 2010 or 2011. And they probably started affecting me immediately, as in the second I was doing them. And the large changes that I saw, like those anecdotes that I told you about, you know, certain observations that I made of my own, those happened within 6 months to a year. It really didn't take long. Of course, this is ongoing, and I notice things that help me all the time, but really big observations were not long in coming. And so, you know, when I talk about, like, I used to have depressive tendencies, I don't anymore, that change, the bulk of that change happened 2010 to 2011, I would say. Maybe a little bit 2012. So a couple of years after I learned these things, at most. Gaming is, in its essence, a consensual hallucination. Can gaming be a form of meditation? Maybe not, though, because games are about focusing your attention on something. And when meditations are about focusing your attention on something, that's usually called concentration meditation. And the ultimate aim of concentration meditation is not necessarily the thing you're concentrating on. It's to keep your mind from concentrating on other things. So I think you could use a game to do that, but I don't necessarily know that that's any better than any other kind of concentration meditation. I don't know. It would be a field you could explore. Someone says, I feel like I've neutralized my emotions, sensations a bit too much in my life. I've had people describe me as cold. The rest of the question is rolled off. Let me try to answer one of that question that I saw, which is to start by saying this is not, the exercises that I talked about today are not about neutralizing emotions in the sense of suppressing them. You don't want to do that. They're actually the opposite. They're actually, if you feel something very negative that's helping cause recurring bad states for you, then, you know, maybe part of what is causing those bad states is the repression of that negative feeling. It's like you don't want to feel that feeling fully, or you're worried about it, or you just feel the need to quarantine it, right? And so that creates some of these negative amplifications and tensions in the body and in reactions and in habits and all that. And so this is the opposite of suppressing those emotions. This is, or suppressing those feelings. This is feel the feelings. Like maybe when you were a little kid, you didn't know how to deal with something, so you had to repress it. But now, if you're an adult, you're in a safe space. Maybe it's okay to feel that thing. And part of what you're doing is just by observing it, you're obviously allowing yourself to feel it. And sometimes that loosens some things. That's not the primary objective of what I was talking about today. The primary objective was just showing you what it's like just to observe these things. But as a side effect of observing these things, you can loosen things up. So I actually also would have described myself as repressing my emotions a fair bit when I was much younger, like, you know, in my teens and 20s and stuff like that. That is very different from what I'm recommending here, and I hope that there's no confusion about that. So when I say that an emotion an emotional state will dissipate when you look directly at it. That's not because you're pushing it away. It's because you're seeing how it really is, or to what degree it really is a substantial thing. And those are very different, and maybe I should just stop talking about it and recommend that you just try it and see what it's like experientially. What I call the observation of thoughts and perception of feelings, I'm talking about meditation. Maybe, I mean, people use the word meditation to mean all kinds of things, and I would say these are related to meditation, but I would actually call them contemplations or exercises, which you can do in a mildly meditative frame of mind, but they're not themselves meditation. But a lot of people would disagree with that and would use the word meditation to describe this kind of thing. How have these habits affected your relationship with positive experience and emotions? Well, it means that when you have positive emotions, you don't take them as seriously. You still enjoy them, totally. Like, I'm not recommending that you try to sabotage your positive emotions, because they don't trap you, right? We don't feel trapped in positive emotions the way we feel trapped in negative emotions. So we don't need to address them the same way. And positive emotions tend not to last as long, right? If we have a lot of positivity, we tend to get used to that after a while, or it tends to play itself out, whereas negativity recur for much longer periods. So, you know, that's why I say that these address negativity, but of course they're applicable to positive feelings in the same way. And what does that mean? Well, maybe it means that you don't form your identity so heavily on being someone who needs to feel positive things all the time, because you know that while positive feelings are nice, they're also insubstantial, just like negative feelings are. And so there's something experientially that happens where you realize they're not as important, but they're nice. They're nice when they happen, and it's good to enjoy things, I think. So I'm not discouraged. A lot of people who use mind-altering substances on a regular basis, tobacco, alcohol, weed, LSD, etc., report the end result being similar or identical to the neutral and detached mindset that you described in your talk. Notwithstanding the well-known negative effects of those in person, do you agree that they can put you in a similar mindset to the one you achieve through the use of these techniques? Well, I don't have that much experience with drugs relative to the kinds of people who make these kinds of statements. I do have some experience with some drugs way in the past, and I would say that for me, they did not help me get into this kind of state at all. I don't want to get too specific about illegal activities, but, one of these substances that many people report gives them a feeling of being expansive and fulfilled and being able to see things from a higher perspective, to me just put me in a hyper-rational. It was simultaneously a hyper-rational and irrational rational state. Like, I was, like, nonstop, hyper-chained thinking about a bunch of things, but the things didn't make any logical sense, but they seemed in the moment like they made logical sense. It was a very different place, so, I never got to any place like that in the small number of illegal or quasi-illegal experiences that I had. But, you know, if that works for other people, then I'm not gonna deny them that. Someone says, what makes me unhappy the most and how do I fight with it? Well, I'm not unhappy that much these days. There is, you know, running a game company and trying to get things done on deadlines is a little bit stressful. And then feeling like I didn't do as good of a job as I should have on certain things makes me feel negative. But not nearly as much as I did some years ago. Even a few years ago when we were in the middle of working on The Witness, and I was still susceptible at that time to getting stressed out. You know, there was a month or two in the middle of that development when I was really in a pretty bad emotional state for a lot of the time, but even so, it was not nearly as bad as what it would have been had I not been practicing observation of my own psychology. Being self-aware of what is going on with you is tremendously useful. So, you know, to this day, I would say that those are the biggest things. I also have stuff, like, I'm single right now. I've been single for a long time. So I have that kind of feeling, like, oh, I wish I was in a relationship with someone or something. But again, whereas going into the distant past, like a decade or two ago, if I had that kind of a feeling, it would feel much more oppressive and unbearable. It would be like, oh my God, my identity is that I'm supposed to be with somebody, and I'm a failure at that right now, and blah, 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 right? All these things that we can get into, whereas now, I'm just not that susceptible to that kind of thought, right? It's just more like, well, you know, I might like it if I was in a good relationship that I was happy with, but I feel like a complete person without that, right? So, those are examples for me, but everybody is different. Making negative interpretations of reality neutral. Not exactly. But have you tried anything about consciously making positive events in life happen to not only mitigate the negative, but add positivity? No. And that's because it sounds a little bit paradoxical, but the things that I talked about are not really about getting rid of negativity. They're about seeing things as they really are. And a beneficial side effect of seeing things as they really are is that we get less trapped in negativity, because negativity is not what we think it is, right? And so I'm giving these things as a recommendation, where if you have frequent negative experiences, these things may help you deal with those experiences or stop them from recurring so much, right? But the technique in the moment, when you're practicing these things is not about trying to get rid of anything. Because if you try to get rid of things, you're not really in the right mindset, right? This is a mindset of investigating what is really true. And then you hope that seeing what is really true internally to you may help you out. But don't believe me about this, right? Don't believe me about what the effects will be. Don't believe me about what you'll see if you look internally. This is all supposed to be that you look internally and you see whatever you see. It's not about forcing things to be positive or negative. And I really don't recommend that. It's a bad road to go down. How do you usually judge if you're actually tired or just trying to avoid the task at hand? How do you manage rest, leisure, sleep versus work and being able to do a lot of things? Well, I have a mild depressive feeling that doesn't bother me very much anymore, but I'm very familiar with it, and it feels like being tired. But it's different from a straight up physical tiredness. And I don't know how to explain it because it's personal feeling to me, but it feels different. And by feeling the two things separately, I just know the difference after all this time, right? And knowing the difference is very helpful to me. But ironically, both are helped if I take a nap, right? If I feel this mildly depressive kind of tiredness, usually that's an amplification on some kind of maybe subtle feeling of genuine tiredness often, and a nap helps. But then also it helps to know that it's not as bad as I think it is. Do I get lonely since I don't work in my company's office most of the time? Not really. I don't actually go to lunch with people in the office and stuff like that. I don't use the office for personal connection. I like go out and do social things for personal connection. Have I ever studied any of the pragmatic esoteric teachings or modern versions like the Robert Anton Wilson prescribed? If by esoteric teachings you mean occult stuff, I don't find that to be a very productive direction. It's never been very appealing to me, though. I do think there are teachings that are very old in the world from which you extract very valuable lessons, but I don't necessarily find that to be the best direction. But maybe it is for some people. Who knows? Am I familiar with Stoicism at all? Only mildly. Do I think there's value in viewing all things as neutral, even positive? I can't say much about what Stoicism actually is like in day-to-day life, and I think many people don't even know, because the modern interpretation of the word Stoic, to my understanding, is not really what Stoicism is actually about. But I can't say much about it because, I don't know much about that tradition. Have I experienced being chronically being mentally tired? Do I treat that just as an emotional condition? I have had some times when I was chronically mentally tired. Sometimes it was because I overworked myself for a long time in succession. But often also it was because I was eating too much sugar, honestly. I found that personally eating a lot of sugar while thinking a lot interferes with my ability to think. So it may not be true for everybody, but it may be true for you. So be careful there. Someone says, I'm not sure how this helps me stay motivated. I'm sure it helps to be not motivated. Well, I think you mean not to be not motivated, but is this enough? Well, let me say the following thing. In my experience, when I am content with what I'm doing and happy, there is a natural energy that bubbles up and gives me, or a natural feeling or mindset that bubbles up and gives me the energy to do things, right? And I don't have to try and make it happen. When I'm in the right conditions, it happens and it naturally powers me, right? And so, if you're stuck in unwarranted negativity, you're preventing that from happening. So by removing these unproductive times from your life, then maybe you're making more space for the fountains of creativity to come to you. That's the way it works for me. Now, there are other ingredients to that, but I think maybe different people's creativity is different as well. So I don't want to prescribe too much there. Wow, is my camera super blurry? I need a better camera, man. Camera's blurry. Have I ever tried applying these techniques directly to competitive gaming and seen positive results acting as an esports gamer? I'm not an esports gamer. I can't say anything about that. Well, scrolling way down the chat. Funny comments. Someone says, do I believe in God? I don't know. It depends on what you mean by that. I don't believe in Abrahamic analog of a man in the sky who judges you based on your deeds and punishes you forever if you do the wrong thing. I don't believe in that. But also modernly, when people say that they're atheists, that actually carries a lot of connotations, like that means they're materialists, and they believe that there's no creative force involved in the world and all that, and I don't believe any of that stuff either, right? I think it's a big stretch to say that stuff. So So I do believe there's something. I don't believe it's a guy who wants to put you in hell for doing the wrong thing. What do you do if you feel like you're wasting your potential and fearing that your whole life will pass without you'll be able to prove something of value? Sometimes I feel like I have to work 24/7 to be able to achieve whatever it is I'm dreaming of, and it makes me lose motivation a lot to see that there's no progress in the short term, so I get stuck in this loop. That is a common experience for a lot of people. And what I would recommend, given these things that we've talked about today, is that when you're having this kind of feeling, so you say, you feel like you are wasting your potential and fearing that your whole life will pass without you being able to produce something of value. Okay, so these ideas about what you'll produce of value are speculations about what will happen in the future. And what often happens in the West is we put a great load on our shoulders about what will happen in the future. And that's functionally useful because it means we're a society about people who plan ahead and care about what will happen and all these things. Those things are good, but sometimes they become pathological. And so what you can do, you don't have control over what's going to happen in the future. You don't even know. Something world-changing could happen. Or, some relationship in your life could change that changes your personal path in the world drastically, right? You don't know the future. What you do know is what's happening right now. So when you say you're fearing that your whole life might pass, or you feel like you're wasting that your potential, you can investigate those feelings and those thoughts in whatever particular moment you're in using the techniques we talked about today, and that will help. And you just have to see. Someone says they think the difference for them is that one kind of tiredness is tiredness with a spinning brain, which constitutes depression. And the other is tired with a cloudy brain, which constitutes exhaustion. Maybe it's something like that, yeah. I mean, I think each individual person has to look and describe to themselves the difference, but there is a difference. I was asking a question that was already addressed about how much the success of my games lets me feel content. It's not really that connected, but I did answer that in length, so you can go back and look at the recording later. How do you observe non-verbal thoughts? Is awareness of your body a thought? I have trouble separating these things. I mean, you can get very picky about classifying. You can classify stuff into many different categories. When I say thoughts, I'm mostly thinking of either verbalizations in your mind, like I have some, wispy, non-verbal construction of the linguistic form. I should have taken care of that box on the counter by now. That's one kind of thought. Another kind of thought might be a memory of something that happened, which is a little more visual, so it's a little bit less verbal, but it's still a pictorial representation in my mind. I'm throwing that together with the linguistic stuff. And there might also be we can start parsing things into subtler and subtler apartments, but maybe that's too much. But like, along with memories of the past, there are expectations of the future, right? So I expect that tomorrow, my lingering expectation that tomorrow somebody will pay me $20 back that they owe me is like a thought, even if it doesn't ever come in fully linguistically, right? It's an operation that my mind is performing with regard to the future. So all of those things I'm categorizing as thoughts. Awareness of my body, I'm not categorizing as a thought. I'm saying that that's just awareness of a sensation, right? So fundamental awareness, like the fact that it's like something to be me, and I see things, and I feel things, is not, for the purposes of this discussion, a thought. That's prior to thought. It's more fundamental. But that would be a whole other discussion that I don't necessarily want to go into. Someone's asking about standing or sitting desk, but that's off topic enough that I won't go into that. Is it a big problem that people don't see things as they are, but see things about the thing? I was like, I didn't care what he said before the fact that he even said it. Maybe, but really what I'm getting at is that you're not really reacting to either of those things. You're reacting to some synthesis of yours that's about... at some meta level about those things. That makes sense. Skipping off topic questions. Question, what's to stop you from using a kind of mindfulness inappropriately? Situations where immediate action is required, it leads itself too readily to the head in the sand kind of abuse. Well, okay. I have a little bit of a beef about that too. Let me talk about two kinds of mindfulness, right? There's a kind of mindfulness that grew up in the New Age scene that is really about trying to feel good. And that's not what I am a proponent of. I think feeling good is nice, but proper use of mindfulness techniques are about knowing the truth. They're not about feeling good. So, if you have an agenda of feeling good, all that can really do is lead you away from the right techniques and the best thing to do in the service of something that is maybe not as important. So, when I talk about these kinds of techniques, even though I'm presenting them to you as a way of breaking apart chains of bad experiences and bad feelings, that's not necessarily in order to feel good. It's for you to see the truth about those bad feelings, that they're not necessarily as bad as you might think they are. Distinction. Subtle difference. I'm gonna sit for a second here. My cam is blurry. I wonder if I have it on blurry settings. Let me take a auto-zoom will not turn on for some reason. It's just... Oh, that zoom, that's not focused. I got big for a second, autofocus. I'll turn on autofocus and see if it helps. Maybe that helped. No. Oh god, maybe that's way worse. Do I trust in antidepressant drugs? I gave a little rant about antidepressants. You can go back and look at that. I make no recommendation pro or con them. I don't have enough experience with them to say anything about them. Do I tailor my present actions based on how I might feel in the future? For instance, future remorse. I call it regret. Well, I think human beings do that. But I'm not sure it's a bad thing entirely. Like, when people start getting into mindfulness and spiritual stuff, they tend to think it's bad to consider the future too much. But if we want to live pragmatically in the real world, consideration of the future is one of the things that we do. So for me, what it becomes is consideration of the future is more like a thing that I do a little bit hypothetically, that I treat at a lower level of reality than what I can immediately observe, but that I do as part of getting my way through life. Like, if I'm programming, I have to have some idea of what that program is going to be in the future, or I can't make it, right? You can't build something without an understanding of where it's going to go, so you have to have temporal planning, right? That's just the thing. And that can affect emotions as well as thoughts, and I think that's totally okay. As long as, if it starts to become unhelpful or pathological, you know how to prevent the pathology. Which for some people is easier said than done, which is why I'm sharing these ideas. Skipping more off-topic questions. Have I ever gotten to a point that I get so detached that getting back to the normal, quote-unquote, is jarring? How do you deal with that? Well, on occasion, yes. But that's usually to do with deeper meditation techniques and not these things. But frankly, actually, it's never been that hard to come back to normal because we've done normal for most of our lives. And we know what it's like. And we're actually very well equipped to deal with normal because we've been practicing that for many years. So it's never been that hard for me. Off topic. I considered talking about someone else's imposter syndrome question, but mentioning certain facts. This is me bringing it up if you want to know. Well, when it comes to imposter syndrome, I'm so glad I had autofocus off during the talk. This is, it's not crazy. I don't believe that most people who think they have imposter syndrome actually have imposter syndrome. I think that they are correctly diagnosing that they are a little bit imposters, in the sense that they're not necessarily that good at the things that their field is about. So for example, if you talk about video game development, you know, which is what I work in, it's very, very complicated and hard, and you couldn't be a master of it without working for decades, probably, unless you're some kind of amazing genius that the world has never seen yet. So if you're only 5 or 10 years into video game development, maybe you're right to feel some of these feelings. Maybe they're appropriate. Maybe you don't really know how to program that well. Maybe you don't really know how to design that well. Maybe you're not as good at organizing things as some of the other people. It's appropriate to feel that if it's true. So then, I don't think the right response is to feel this like, oh, woe is me, I have imposter syndrome kind of thing that people say on the internet. I think rather, just come to grips with those feelings. Be like, yeah, it's not true that I'm as good at programming as I wish I were. So let me work on it. And let me get better. Right? That's all. If you think you can go into a field where multi-decade expertise is necessary and good at it and be good at it within a couple years, that's the delusion. Imposter syndrome is not the delusion. Thinking that you should be good after 2 years is the delusion. Thinking that you're not on some long trail of extensive skill building. That's what I have to say about it. It's kind of off topic, but the way it's on topic is that when you're feeling this imposter syndrome, you can use these techniques that I talked about today just to investigate it and see what it's like. How do I work with accusations of pretentiousness? It's been something that's been thrown around a lot in the context of my project, especially recently. Admittedly, in many cases, rather unfavorably and pejoratively, but I'm not sure how to tell if there's legitimately something of value to be taken from it, as something to improve on, or if I should just dismiss it as a personal insult. Obviously, I don't try to be pretentious or pedantic, and actively try to be sincere and comment cut off there. But that's enough to talk about. So definitely people have said that the things that I do are pretentious. I disagree in my own case. The observation that I make is that often that is coming from some kind of societal embarrassment to talk in a certain ways about certain things. Like if you are too earnest or too obviously speaking about large topics that are supposed to be very meaningful, then people automatically label that pretentious. Because, hey man, you're not just being a regular bro or something, right? But it's really because they're maybe a little bit afraid or embarrassed to go there. Maybe not as an individual, but maybe even societally. And that's a problem, because that feeds into nihilism, right? Maybe we end up in a place where, as a society, we're lacking meaning because we shoot down too many people who approach these subjects by saying they're pretentious. That said, you are certainly welcome, if people say that you're being pretentious, to actually introspect and honestly ask yourself, am I pretentious or not? Or am I sincere? right? If you, do you have an emotional reaction to being called for attention? Do you have a physical body flushing that happens, right? Investigate those, because they're about something, and you might learn something by investigating those. So do that. And see what you find, and see if it leads you to any further understanding of your work about whether it's really contagious or not. I'm getting a little tired now, so I think one or two more questions and then we're done. I'm just going to see in the order in which I scroll down, except my browser crashed. That might be the end of the questions, guys. My browser is dead, so that's going to be my excuse. I'm losing my voice a little bit. I need to work on speaking more relaxedly for a longer period of time. The autofocus is going crazy. So we're going to use that to mark the end of the thing. I'm sorry I can't see any more questions. Thanks everybody for stopping by. And this will be up on YouTube if you missed some part of it. And we'll probably do another Q&A later on, because I imagine people may have more questions. There are probably questions I didn't get to tonight. But also, this is different from the sort of thing that I often talk about, so it seems likely that people might have more questions, so maybe we'll do a Q&A tomorrow or in a couple days after people have had time to see the YouTube thing. Thank you everybody for stopping by, and I'll see you later. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.